A young man with no hope and a gun against his head.
I took a gun out from underneath my bed, and I put that cold barrel up to my temple.
See what saved his life on today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, welcome to the program. Keith Robinson felt invisible. He was born into a broken home, and the only time he felt seen was when he was in trouble. By the age of 17, Keith had a lengthy rap sheet and was going nowhere fast, until one woman noticed him for the first time.
I looked at my life, and I didn't feel like I had a hope for my future. I took a gun out from underneath my bed, and I put that cold barrel up to my temple. From the earliest time I could remember, I felt distant from my parents. My father was sick. He was in and out of the hospital. He developed a debilitating disease when he was in his early 30s. My parents also fought a lot during those years, and that left me as a child feeling like I was lost in the world. And I felt invisible until I did something wrong. So I learned to do wrong a lot. I got picked up by the police when I was 12 years of age for shoplifting. So at 15, I was in trouble. I was dealing drugs, and things were really volatile at home. My father and I got into a huge fight. We exchanged a lot of hurtful words. I walked away, and I slammed the door to my bedroom, and I screamed the words out loud, "I hate you." The very next morning, I walked outside. I heard my mom's voice trailing off as she said, "Keith, we're taking your dad back to the hospital today. He's not feeling very well." I was sitting at a friend's house that evening, getting ready to get high and get drunk with my friends. My mom pulled up outside my friend's house, honking the horn to the car, and I walk outside, and my mom jumped out of the car and got close to my face, and she said, "Keith, get in the car. Your dad's dead." In that moment, it felt like someone had taken their fist, balled it up, and hit me in the gut and knocked the wind out of me. The last words that I ever spoke to my father were the words, "I hate you." Deep down inside of me, I really hated myself. When we buried my father, I felt like a piece of me went into the ground with him. I felt empty and alone. I felt like I had done something to cause all the pain in my family. When I was 17 years of age, I got pulled over at 3 a.m. and I was three times the legal limit when they did the breathalyzer on me. I also had possession of narcotics on me that night. And so I was sitting in my house and on house arrest, and I was thinking about ending my life. I took a gun out from underneath my bed, and I put that cold barrel up to my temple. Something inside of me that same day said, "I can't let my younger brother see me like this." And so I put the gun underneath my bed, thinking of another way that I could possibly end my life. On that same day that I thought about ending my life, my mother got a phone call. There was a lady that attended a church not too far from our house. There was a prayer meeting. And in that prayer meeting, one of the young people in that youth group asked for prayer for Keith Robinson. This woman happened to be standing there in the room and said, "I know Keith Robinson." And so she decided to call my mom on that Saturday. And she said to her, "I'd like to come pray for Keith." I didn't want anything to do with that. I could not believe in a God that I couldn't see, because everything I saw when I looked outside my window and when I looked in the mirror pointed to failure. The doorbell rang and I went to the door. She was standing on my doorstep with a Bible in her hand. And she said, "Keith, I'm here to pray for you." And I told her in that moment, "I hate God." And she looked right back at me without even hesitating or thinking and said, "Keith, you may hate God and you may even hate me, but I want to tell you today that Jesus Christ loves you and has an incredible plan for your life." In 17 years of living, no one had ever told me that Jesus loved me and had a plan for my life. I walked to my bedroom, and she followed right behind me with that Bible in her hand. I got in my bed and pulled the covers up over my head. And she gently took those covers, pulled them off of me, and put her hand on my shoulder and said, "Keith, I just want to pray for you today." And I remember very distinctly the prayer that she prayed in that moment. "Jesus, I know that you're real, and I pray that you would speak to Keith's heart and change his life. Amen." When she finished that prayer, I thought, that's it. She left the Bible at the foot of my bed, and for the next couple of weeks, I got beside my bed and I began to pray every night her prayer, except I turned it around into a question to God. I prayed like this: "Jesus, if you're real, will you change my life?" 2 weeks later, I got permission to go to church from my probation officer. The pastor, it seemed, said everything that I needed to hear that day. He read the scripture, John 3:16 and 17, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." I realized in that moment that God wasn't mad at me. He wasn't here to condemn me, but he wanted to change my life. So I stood to my feet that morning because I knew I needed to receive this love and let it change me. I knew I needed to receive Christ in my life. And the same woman that had come into my bedroom just 2 weeks before and prayed for me got out of her seat and met me as I walked to the front of that church. She put her arms around me and I fell on my knees and I began to pray in that moment, "Jesus, I know you're real. Change my life." In that moment, I felt God like I've never felt him before. In that moment, God began to change my heart. He took this stone-cold heart and he began to massage it with his grace and with his mercy and with his forgiveness. And a flood of tears began to pour out of my eyes. And I remember just laying there at the front of that church for what seemed like a half an hour as I repented of my sins, as I asked Christ to forgive me and to change me and to make me new. I felt the healing of God come over me emotionally, mentally, and spiritually. Every addiction in my life was completely broken. So after I gave my life to Christ, the evidence of my change was being seen by all. My probation officer, my high school principal, my teachers. So everything in my life began to turn around. And my pastor wrote a letter to the judge, and he read it that day in the courtroom for all to hear. And he told the story about how God had changed my life. And I'll never forget when the judge read the sentencing that day. He started with these words. "Against my better judgment," he said, "I'm gonna give you one more chance. I didn't get what I deserved. I got something far better, and that's called grace." I began to pursue God's plan and God's call for my life. I went on to college and graduated with a 4.0 summa cum laude at the top of my class. Today, I'm the pastor at a church in my hometown. I'm reminded of the incredible favor that God has blessed me with in my life. He's given me what I could never imagine, and certainly more than I ever deserved.
And he'll do the same for you. He came that you might have life and life more abundantly. When we do things that are wrong, and we know they're wrong, when we do them anyway, we get separated from God. And somehow we get it in our heads and in our heart that God is disappointed with us, that God's angry with us, that God doesn't want to have anything to do with us because we've messed up. We're no longer perfect. We're no longer worthy in his sight. He doesn't want to have anything to do with us, that he's angry. We get that impression and we start living that way. We start acting that way. We start thinking we're rejected by God when the reality is we haven't changed a thing. He still loves us. He still cares for us. He's still concerned about us. He still wants very much for us to have a relationship with him, where we can hear his voice, where we can see and appreciate all the good things that he's doing for us. It's that sin that separates, not that he moves away. What happens is our perception gets warped by it, and we start assuming the very worst about God, instead of knowing he loves us, he forgives us. We're still his child. Start realizing you're made in the image of God. The very breath you breathe came from him. The reason you have consciousness, the reason you have eternity in your heart is because God placed it there. And he placed it for one reason, so that we could be with him, that we could have fellowship with him, we could have communion with him. He would come down in the cool of the evening and talk with us. That's his plan. That's his dream. And he hasn't given up on it. Now, when you look at Keith's life, Keith had given up. He'd given up on life. He was doing things that he knew would destroy him, taking things he knew would kill him. And he did all of that, somehow thinking it would cause the hurt to go away. It would all be medicated away. He wouldn't have to feel it anymore. Not knowing that there was a much better way, that he could give all that pain, all that hurt, all that rejection, he could give it all to God, and God would take care of it all. And in return, give Keith life and life more abundantly. Here are the verses that inspired Keith, and I hope they inspire you. It's John 3:16, and a verse we don't often quote, the one right following, verse 17. For God so loved the world, that's you, for God so loved you, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever, that's you again, whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Now, if you believe that, if you understand, he didn't come to condemn you, he came to save you. If you believe that, here's the prayer. It's the same prayer that Keith prayed. Jesus, if you're real, could you change me? Could you save me? Could you make me new again? Could you do that for me? Could you come for me? And if you pray that with all of your heart, he'll answer. He'll respond. He'll show you. He'll show up for you so that you know that all that's been written about him is true. He wants to demonstrate his love for you. The turnaround you see in Keith can be the turnaround for you if you just go to the same source and ask the same thing. Jesus, if you're real, could you show up for me? If you want help with that prayer, we're here for you. All you have to do is pick up the phone and call us. Number's toll free, 888-777-1999. Well, we're going to take a break, but when we come back, I want to pray for you. And I want to pray for those specifically with chronic pain. We've got a story of a woman who suffered from chronic pain for 7 years.
My feet were constantly hurting. They would hurt just laying down, and I would dread getting up in the morning.
Find out how Jesus cured her after this. Well, we just saw the story of Keith's life verse. It's from John 3:16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. If you have a life verse and want to share it with us, we want to hear from you. All you have to do is go to our Facebook site. That's on the screen right now at Facebook at 700 Club Interactive. And just post it and tell us your story. And we'd love to tell your story about how a verse from the Bible changed your life. Well, Crystal Stickle loves to go outside and take a walk, even though she couldn't take a single step without pain for 7 long years. Crystal's feet even hurt when she was lying down, until the day she was sitting on her floor and watching television.
I had a limp. I couldn't walk down the stairs without holding onto the railing. I remember just thinking about every step and being very careful where I stepped. My feet were constantly hurting.
Crystal Stickle doesn't know how the pain in her feet started back in 2001, All she knows is that it made her life much more difficult.
Just came on little by little. I feel like something was pushing on my arch and just constant pain. My left foot hurt more than my right foot, even though they both started hurting.
The pain only got worse.
They would hurt just laying down, and I would dread getting up in the morning. They would hurt as soon as they hit the floor, and walking, and I could not run, anything like that. They would just hurt.
Her doctor told her she had bone spurs, and there was nothing he could do. He gave her foot exercises and prescribed pain medication, but neither worked.
I changed my life because of my feet. Finally, after about 7 years, they finally just hurt all the time.
One day she was watching the 700 Club, and Gordon began to pray for viewers.
And so I put my hands on my left foot because it hurt the worst. And then I thought, no, I'm going to put my hands on both feet.
There's someone crying out for the soles of your feet. There's pain in your arch. It's really bad in the left foot, and God's healing that now for you.
I just knew that that prayer was for me. I had tears of joy. I cried for an hour after my feet were healed, at least. And I still sometimes get tears when I think of what they used to feel like and what they feel like now. My feet feel like new. I feel like God has just given me new feet. And He's taken all the pain away. He cares about every detail of my life, right down to the soles of my feet.
Now she's enjoying some activities for the first time in years.
I love walking. In fact, I walk a lot. I can keep up with my family, my children, and I don't have to think about constantly being in pain.
She says throughout her journey, she has learned something wonderful.
Never give up praying. I prayed for 7 years for my feet to be healed, and God heard my prayers. He still heals today. We read in our Bibles that He healed the lame and the blind, and He brought people back from the dead. He can do all that, and He still does it today. I'm proof of it.
He still does it today. The Bible says Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And if we can get to Him, if we can break through to Him, if we can break through all our preconceptions, all the things that we think somehow separate us from God, limit His power, if we can break through to that point of belief for anything, all things are possible for them that believe. And for Crystal, it took 7 years to get to that point, but she got there. And that can happen to you, and we're going to pray for you and ask for the same miracle working God to move in your life. So we believe in the power of prayer, and we're going to pray for you. But first, we've got some prayer requests that have come in online, so let's go over to Jessica.
Well, Gordon, Angela writes in, please pray for my total healing. I have been diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, mainly affecting my legs. It has been debilitating and it has robbed me of my life and happiness. Please pray that God touches me and completely delivers me from this disease. Ron says, I have tremors that shake me all night as I sleep. I am always tired since I do not get much rest. I believe God can heal me. Please agree with me in prayer for my healing. Gordon?
All right, well, let's pray for them, and we're going to pray for you as well. And let's create a great circle of prayer. And let's do the same thing that Crystal did. She said, I'm going to lay hands on my feet. I believe faith is an act. And when you show yourself that you're acting in faith, that's when things really start to break and to manifest. And then you get the breakthrough when you act your faith. So we're going to pray. So lay your hands. First, let's pray for Ron and Angela and ask for God to heal them. And then we're going to pray for you. Lord, first we lift up Angela, and we just ask for the angels to come around her and surround her. We ask for the hedge of protection to be around her, and we command that spirit of infirmity to leave her now. That which is seeking to destroy and kill her, we rebuke it now in Jesus' name. and leave her, and no more symptoms of MS, no more symptom of nerve damage, but we speak peace to her body, and especially peace in her legs. Be free now, in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, we lift up Ron to you, and we ask that these tremors stop now, in Jesus' name, and that his nervous system be restored and be made whole. Manifest yourself to Ron. Give him the peace that he's looking for. Just surround him with your love. And now, Lord, for those who are praying, for those in chronic pain, chronic illness, we just ask now, as they lay hands on that area of the body that needs healing, we join with them. We join in agreement, and your word says, when two or more agree touching anything, it shall be done. So we agree, and we touch, and we believe now, and we declare over them, be healed and be made whole. There's someone watching, and you're just wondering, is this true? You had a fracture in your left heel, and it never healed properly, and there's pain. And God's healing that for you and taking all that pain. It just left you. You're amazed. It just left, and you're completely healed and restored. Go and do what you couldn't do before and realize God has healed you. Now, Lord, I ask for peace to come and the tranquility that only is in you. Give it to us now, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've been touched by God, we want to share in your good report, so let us know. You can either go on Facebook and post it there, or you can give us a call, 888-777-1999. And we're here for you, and we believe in prevailing prayer. So if you need prayer and continued prayer, all you have to do is call us. It's our honor, our privilege to pray for you. Well, coming up, a 7-year-old who worried about his next meal. Find out how his prayers were answered in a way he never expected. Up next. In Peru, a young couple worked 15-hour days, and even with two jobs, they barely made enough to feed their family. So their 7-year-old son prayed for help, and here's how people like you became the answer to that prayer.
Adrian is only 7 years old, but very mature for his age. He knows all too well the challenges facing his parents.
My dad works as a driver's assistant. My mom sells candies and breakfast porridge. But they don't make enough money, and I worry a lot.
Adrian's dad never finished school, and his low-paying job was the only one he could find. He works 15 hours a day and only earns about $10.
My little brother was sick, and my mom didn't have money to buy the medicine, and sometimes we didn't have money to buy food.
Adrian is the only Christian in his family. He goes to a Bible club every Saturday near his home. So he began to pray for his family.
I prayed, "Dear God, please help our family to make enough so we can eat and I can keep going to school."
To help the family, Operation Blessing set up a small store for Adrian's mom, Maria, right next to their home. Here, they sell notebooks, school supplies, and other household items. And Adrian loves helping his mom in the store after school.
Thanks, Operation Blessing, for helping my family.
And thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of the answer to that wonderful boy's prayer. If you're not a member, join with us. Join in everything we're doing around the world. It's real easy to do. Just call us, 888-777-1999. Just say, "I want to join up. I want to be a part of everything you're doing." How much is it to be a member? Just $20 a month, 65 cents a day, and you join with tens of thousands of people that want to bless people around the world. So if that's you, give us a call, or you can log on to CBN.com. Well, we still have time to answer some questions on prayer, so let's go back to Jessica.
Well, Gordon, we have a question in from Matt. He asks, I was diagnosed with bone cancer and it's spreading. I read in the Bible that if we confess our sins and pray, we will be healed. Well, I've confessed and prayed about everything I can think of and even asked God if there is anything I left out. Still no healing. How am I supposed to believe the Bible when nothing changes? Gordon?
Matt, you're actually expressing how much you don't believe the Bible by what you're doing right now. And I know that sounds harsh. I want to be direct with you because you've got cancer and you need the answer here. If you think that there's unforgiven sin in your life, you haven't fully embraced what Jesus did for you on the cross. He forgave everything. He forgave even the sins you haven't committed yet. When you understand the completeness of what he does, then you're no longer worried about confession. If you do have any worries, say, Lord, I know there's some things I've done I don't even remember anymore. Could you forgive them? And when you get to that point of acceptance, that when he said it's finished, it's done, then you have that point of belief where you can believe for the breakthrough for you. Do it that way. We leave you these words from Philippians. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he's done.